So now we're gonna switch gears and talk about the treatment of hypernatremia or elevated sodium. The most important concept is that you don't want to quickly change the sodium concentration in the blood. In this case, you don't want to drop it from high to normal or to low very quickly, because that will lead to cerebral edema. So as a rule of thumb, the sodium concentration should be decreased by no more than 10 to 12 milliequivalents or millimoles per 24 hours. Otherwise, the osmolality in the plasma will be too low compared to the osmolality within the brain tissue. And this discrepancy in intravascular osmolality and brain osmolality will lead to shifting of free water from the intravascular space to the interstitium, including the brain, which will lead to severe cerebral edema. So the brain will swell up, and since it's contained in the skull, it will lead to intracranial hypertension, which may lead to seizures, tremors, neurologic deficits, and even coma and death. So never, never drop sodium too fast, and try to maintain this drop within about 10 to 12 milliequivalents every 24 hours. So step number one, when you're approaching these patients, you want to determine their volemic status, so volume status, to see if they need a bolus of fluids or they don't. And if the patient is deemed hypovolemic, so this patient is probably in shock and it needs the rapid resuscitation. So the way you correct hypovolemia in this patient with elevated sodium concentration is that you give them a bolus of crystalloid that has a sodium concentration similar to patient sodium concentration. So if the patient's sodium concentration is 185, you probably want to bolus a crystalloid with sodium about 180 to 190, so plus minus 5 as a rule of thumb. So how do you make this contrived solution? Because you may not have access to commercial solution with such a high sodium content. There's a formula you can utilize in order to calculate how much concentrate solution you need to add to a different solution to make this contrived fluid. So in this formula, you see that Vx is the volume of the hypertonic saline, 7.2%, that you can add to the bag of a regular crystalloid in order to make a final solution with the desired sodium content. And I'll give you an example. C1 is the desired sodium concentration in the final solution. C2 is the current sodium concentration in a crystalloid solution. V1 is a desired volume of a final solution. And C3, it's a current sodium concentration in the hypertonic saline. So if you're using a 7.2 hypertonic saline, it contains about 1,232 millimoles of sodium per liter. So if we go back to Max and try to apply this math to his case, that's what we're going to do. So his sodium concentration on blood work was 185 millimoles per liter, and he was hypovolemic. So he was in shock, so we wanted to give him a fluid bolus, but we didn't want to give him a regular, let's say, LRS, because that can drop his sodium too fast. That will lead to cerebral edema, so it's not safe. His weight is 20 kilograms. All right, so that's how we calculated how we're going to make this bag of contrived solution with sodium 185 out of LRS that we had, and hypertonic saline 7.2% that we had. So first of all, we calculate how much fluid we need. So in his case, let's say we would like to start with 20 mL per kg bolus. So that will put us at 400 mL, but we knew that 20 mL per kg may not be enough, so we may need to repeat it. So we decided, let's just make a liter of this fluid in case we need to repeat fluid boluses. All right, so Vx is the amount of hypertonic saline we want to put into the bag of LRS to make this contrived solution with sodium 185. So 185 minus 130, so 185 is our desired sodium, minus 130 is the concentration of sodium in LRS, our baseline solution, times 1,000 mils, it's the amount of fluid we want to make at the end, divided by the concentration of sodium in the hypertonic saline, which is 1,232. So if you do the math, you will get 44.6 mils of hypertonic saline that you need to add to 955.4 mils of LRS to make a final 1 liter, 1,000 mils of a solution with the sodium content of 185 millimoles per liter. So now we have this solution that we can bolus to this patient safely without being afraid of decreasing sodium concentration too fast that may lead to cerebral edema. Step number two. So once you corrected hypovolemia, now you can calculate the free water deficit and slowly correct this hypernatremia over time. So since this patient is hypernatremic, so sodium is elevated, likely there is a free water deficit. By giving this free water deficit back to this patient, we can correct sodium over time. So there's a specific formula for free water deficit calculation. So first of all, you need to know patient sodium, then divide it by desired sodium. So let's say the patient is starting with 185. We're going to divide it by the desired sodium, let's say 150. Then we're going to subtract 1, multiply by 0.6, and body weight. The end result will be liters of free water that you should administer to this patient to correct hypernatremia. And we're going to practice it on max, but just be aware that you may have several sources of free water that you're going to administer to this patient. So first of all, D5W or 5% dextrose would be a great source of free water. So it doesn't contain any sodium in it. It's just pure dextrose. And once it gets metabolized by the liver, there will be nothing but just water. Second option is half-strength saline. So this option is not your pure, you know, source of free water. So it contains some sodium, about 77 millimoles per liter, but it could be utilized as one of the options. But you will need to administer more of this solution to provide the similar amount of free water as you would do with D5W. Finally, you can also think about an alternative route of administration of free water, such as NG tube. So now you can just give sterile water or like fresh tap water through the tube to the patient to provide the source of free water. But also if the patient is drinking and is able to hold it down, you can just give it as regular water, but in a controlled fashion so that the patient's sodium doesn't drop quickly overnight, which will lead to cerebral edema. So in the example of Max, again, we calculated the free water deficit by using the formula we just talked about. And the max of sodium was 185 to start with. Our goal was to drop it to 155. So we subtracted 1 from it times 0.6 times 20 kilograms. So we got the final amount of 2,320 mils of free water that we need to give to Max in order to drop sodium from 185 to 155. Unfortunately, if we do it overnight, that would be a very fast drop, right? Because it will drop from 185 to 155, which is 30 millimoles drop, and that's not safe. So in order to calculate how long it should take for you to do it safely, you need to divide this number by 12 millimoles per day. And in this case, we'll get 2.5 days, about 60 hours. That should be your duration of administration of this calculated free water deficit in order to drop your sodium very slowly in a safe manner. In this case, we decided to go with dextrose 5% because also he was hypoglycemic. It was a perfect choice for us. And if you divide this calculated number by 60 hours, we got about 39-40 mil per hour of 5% dextrose that we gave to Max in order to slowly drop the sodium concentration. Be aware that this is just an approximate calculation. If, let's say, Max has ongoing losses with panting, hypothermia, diarrhea, he actually may need more than that. So we would start with this rate, but also we will reassess his sodium every 4 hours and then adjust the rate as needed if the sodium is not dropping the way we want it to drop. So step number three, it's monitoring of sodium concentration, Q4 to Q8 hours, depending on the degree and a degree of the hypernatremia and stability of your patient. And then you're going to adjust the fluid rate as needed empirically, and then you're going to count for ongoing losses.